Let's now attempt to find a solution for the logistic differential equation. And we already found some constant solutions. We can think through that a little bit, just as a little bit of a review from the last few videos. So if this is the t-axis and this is the n-axis, we already saw that if n of 0, if at time equals 0, our population is 0, there's no one to reproduce. And this differential equation is consistent with that. Because if n is 0, this thing is going to be 0. And so our rate of change is going to be 0 with respect to time. And so our population just won't change. It'll just stay at 0, which is nice because that's what would actually happen in a real population. So that gives us the constant solution that n of t is equal to 0. That's one solution to this differential equation. Not that interesting. A 0 population will never grow or change. The other constant solution is, well, what if our population started at the maximum of what the environment could sustain? And in that situation, this term is going to be k over k, which is 1. 1 minus 1 is 0. And so in there, the population would also not change. It would just stay at k, and so the rate of change would just stay at 0. So that's another constant solution, that we start at the maximum population, and then this differential equation tells us a scenario that never changes. But we said, hey, look, well, there could be something interesting that happens if our initial condition, which we called n sub naught, that's our n of 0, at time equals 0, if we start someplace in between, maybe closer, much below our eventual ceiling, I guess. Because if we're a lot below our eventual ceiling, this thing is going to be a small fraction. This thing is going to be close to 1. And so the rate of change is going to be pretty close to being proportional to n, which is going to, and when we're thinking that, we can kind of, it might look something like that. As n increases, our rate of change increases. But then as n approaches k, this thing is going to approach 1, this thing is going to approach 0, and so it's going to overwhelm this, and our rate of change is going to approach 0. And so we could imagine a scenario where we asymptote towards k. And let's see if we can solve this to find this n of t, this n of t, to find the actual analytic expression for this n of t right over here. Because this is interesting. This is what could be used to model populations that would be more consistent with a Malthusian mindset. So let's see if we can do that. And to do that, we just have to realize this is a completely different, this is a separable differential equation. And we're assuming is a function of t. We're going to solve for an n of t that satisfies this. And so we just have to separate it from the explicit t's. But there are no explicit t's here, so it's quite easy to do. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this part right over here. And I'm going to divide both sides by that. I'm going to leave the r on the right-hand side. It'll make things, I think, a little bit easier as we try to solve for n of t. So let me just do that. So this is going to be equal to 1 over n times 1 minus n over k. 1 minus n over k times dn dt times dn dt is equal to r. And another way we could think about it, let me just continue to tackle it this way. So we get that. And now what I want to do is take the antiderivative of both sides with respect to t. Well, this is pretty straightforward. That's just going to be rt times some constant. But what is this going to be? This is kind of this messy thing. And maybe if we could break this out, if we can expand this into two fractions, do a little bit of partial fraction expansion, maybe we can come up with an expression that's a little bit easier to find the antiderivative of. And so I'm hoping that I can find an a and a b where a over n plus b over 1 minus n over k is equal to this business, is equal to 1 over n times 1 minus n over k. Let's see if we can find an a and a b. And this is just partial fraction expansion. If this looks unfamiliar to you, I encourage you to review that part on Khan Academy. Do a search for partial fraction expansion on Khan Academy. So how do we do it? Well, let's just add these two right over here. So this, if we take the sum right over here, this is going to be a times this, which is a minus a over k n plus b times this plus b n over the product of these two. So it's just going to be n times 1 minus n over k. One way to think about it, I just multiply the numerator and the denominator of this one by 1 minus n over k. So a times 1 minus n over k is that, n times 1 minus n over k is that, and I multiplied the numerator and denominator of this both by n, bn, and n times that, and then I added the two now that I had this the same denominator. So that's just adding fractions with unlike denominators. It's going to be equal to this, 1 over n times 1 minus n over k. And now we could try to think about, well, what is a and b going to be equal to, or what can they be equal to? Well, I have a constant term here. I don't have any n term here. I could say that maybe I have a 0 times an n. And that actually helps things a little bit. Because maybe we could say that this thing, that this plus this, which are the coefficients on n, are going to sum up to 0. And that this, which is our a, is going to be equal to 1. And that's pretty nice. So we could say that a is equal to 1. A is equal to 1. And then if a is equal to 1, we have negative 1 over k, negative 1 over k plus b is equal to 0. Well, what's b going to be? Well, b would be equal to 1 over k. So we can rewrite this as, 1 over n plus 1 over k plus 1 over k over 1 minus n over k. 1 minus n over k over k, and then times dn dt, dn dt is equal to r. So I just did a little bit of partial fraction expansion, and I'll give myself a little bit of real estate. Let me clear this out. You can rewind the video and review that if you find it necessary. So let's do that. And so how does this help us? Well, hey, you know, you probably might be recognizing the antiderivative of 1 over n, and you might even see this. So let's just think through this a little bit. We know the antiderivative of 1 over n is the natural log, just in a new color, is the natural log of the absolute value of n. And we can see the derivative of that with respect to n is equal to 1 over n. And if we were to find the derivative of this with respect to t, derivative with respect to t of the natural log of the absolute value of n is equal to, this is going to be the derivative of this with respect to n, times the derivative of n with respect to t, times dn dt. And we could do the same thing over here. Notice, I have an expression. What would be the derivative of this expression right over here? It would be negative 1 over k, if I'm talking about the derivative with respect to n. It would be negative 1 over k. I have a positive 1 over k here, and I can even make it negative. I can clear this out of the way. Instead of having a positive there, I could have a double negative. So a double negative, I haven't changed the value of it. And notice, now this is the derivative of this, which makes it very nice for u substitution, or you might be already used to doing this thing in your head. And so we know that the derivative with respect to n, let me write this in a new color, we know that the derivative with respect to n of the natural log of 1 minus n over k, once again, this comes straight out of the chain rule, it's going to be the derivative of this with respect to n, which is negative 1 over k, times the derivative of this whole thing with respect to this thing, which is times 1 over 1 minus n over k, which is exactly what we have over here. But if I were to take the derivative of this with respect to t, so the derivative with respect to t of the natural log of 1 minus n over k, it's going to be the derivative of this with respect to n, which is that, which is what we just found. It's going to be this. So copy and paste. It's going to be that. Times the derivative of n with respect to t, just straight out of the chain rule, dn dt. Well, notice, we have a dn dt, we can multiply it times each of these things. And actually, why not? Let's just do that, just to make it clear. Because this is really, you know, this isn't so much differential equations, but sometimes some of the calculus that we learned not too long ago, And even, frankly, some of the algebra, it's nice to not skip steps. So if I distribute this, edit, paste, whoops, I wanted to copy and paste. So copy and paste. So I have that. And then I have, I can copy and paste. So that, I'm just distributing this business right over here. So I get that. Now let me clean it up a little bit. So I have that right over here. And of course, we have this being equal to r. If I take the antiderivative of this with respect to t, well, I'm just going to get this. I am just going to get this. This minus this right over that. So let's do that. Let's take the antiderivative with respect to t. So the left-hand side, I'm going to get the natural log. The antiderivative of that with respect to t is the natural log of the absolute value of n. And then minus the antiderivative of this with respect to t is the natural log of the absolute value of 1 minus n over k is equal to, oh, and let's not forget, let's say it's, and we're going to have some constant here. I want to find a pretty general solution. Let's call it c1, is equal to the antiderivative of this with respect to t is r times t, maybe plus some other constant, just like that. And now, I'm going to assume that my n of t meets this assumption right over here. And so assume n of t is going to be less than k and greater than 0. That means that this n is always going to be positive. And if n is always between 0 and k, that means that this thing is always going to be positive. And so that helps me clear things up a little bit. Actually, let me do it in this color. That helps me get rid of that. Helps me get rid of that. I can instead throw some parentheses here. And why don't I subtract the c1 from both sides? So that would get rid of it here. So edit, cut, and paste. So I have the c1 there. And I know I'm overwriting my own work, which is not making it look as clean as possible. But I'm just trying to clean it up a little bit. And now, hey, I have an arbitrary constant that I haven't really solved for yet, minus another constant. Well, let me just call this some other constant. Let me just call it a general c. So let me just call this c. So clear. And I'm just going to call that c. I am just going to call that c. And I could even simplify this a little bit. But actually, I just realized I'm 13 minutes into this video, which is longer than I like to do. So let's continue this in the next video. I was getting excited because I'm so close to solving for an n of t that satisfies our logistic differential equation. Very, very exciting.